Hey, what's up everyone? So today we'll be covering one of the most talented youngsters out there in chess at the moment, and it is Nihal Sarin. Nihal Sarin, being a chess prodigy, he achieved the title of Grandmaster at just the age of 14, and he's also the fourth youngest player in history to cross the ELO rating of 2600. So he's actually dubbed as the next potential world champion, and sometimes he's also known as the next Magnus Carlsen as well because of his tender age. And currently he's just at the age of 17, but then he's there in the top 100 in the world rankings. And today we are covering a very special game in which Nihal Sarin plays against Francesco Sonis in the World Online Youth Championship that was held in 2020. And Nihal Sarin actually won the Gazprom Brilliancy Prize for this particular game. So I hope you'll enjoy that, and let's just get straight to the game. So Nihal, being white, he plays d4. And we have Francesco playing d5. And then we have knight f3, knight f6, and c4, going for the queen's gambit. We have e6. Knight c3, bishop b4. So he's going for the Ragusan defense, and he plays bishop g5, which is just a normal opening move. So we have d into c4, and Nihal plays e4. So you can see that white's center is pretty strong at the moment after that e4 push, and in turn he's also planning to capture the pawn. So we have h6. So we have bishop takes knight, queen takes knight. So overall in this position, it's, you know, it's good for white, but then because white has lost this strong dark squared bishop, you know, black seems to be in a good spot as well. So now we have bishop into c4, and we have c5. So black is threatening counterplay at the moment, and he directly goes for c5. So now over here, white has a lot of options, but capturing the pawn with d into c5 may turn out to be a bit risky because we have bishop into c3 and the queen would come into the picture, and you know, this white bishop would be hanging as well, so it wouldn't look ideal at all. So for the c5, what Nihal plays is he castles. So in terms of what Nihal is thinking, you can see that all his pieces are developed, and the king is also safe at the moment. But you can see that black's queen side seems to be in a lot of mess. You know, both his pieces are dead at the moment, and they haven't even been developed yet. So white is just trying to gain advantage for that. So here we have c into d5, and we have e5. So instead of capturing the pawn straight away, white wants to gain some tempo, and he plays e5. So let's find out why he actually played e5. So after queen d8, now we have e4. So now it makes sense because he played e5, thereby giving room for his knight to go over to knight e4. So now black castles. So you might be wondering, you know, why didn't black play knight c6? You know, I mean, this black is having an extra pawn, so he could just play knight c6. So, but this doesn't make any difference because now we have bishop e5 pinning the knight, and now this pawn is hanging and it will be gone, so there's no point in trying to save a lost pawn. Black castling makes absolute sense. So we have knight into d4. So he doesn't capture with the queen because obviously white doesn't want to exchange his queens at such an early point, especially when white has an advantage with all his developed pieces. So over here, black plays queen c7. So at first glance, you might seem that this seems to be a very strong move because, you know, black is attacking this e5 pawn as well as attacking the bishop. So this seems to be a very strong move by Francesco, but it is at this point that Nihal plays a very fabulous move for white. It's not a brilliant move that requires a lot of thinking, but still, it is a very strong move, so You can pause the video if you'd like and analyze the board and try to figure out the move. So what Nihal plays over here is knight f6. This is a very brilliant move by Nihal, because now if black does capture like g into f6, then we have queen g4 check, and if black goes over there to h7 to, you know, save the h6 pawn, then you got e into f6, and white is now threatening g7 mate. So obviously the rook will have to come over to g8, but then you have bishop d3 check as well. Now the king will have to go over to h8, and now we have queen e4, and this situation is very, very ugly for black. So it is best for black not to capture the knight. So over here black plays king h8, but now Nihal plays another brilliant move, and he plays queen c2. So now we can see that white is now threatening mate at h7. So now black is forced to capture the knight. Black has to, so he plays g into f6, and now the most subtle move by white. I mean, you could call it such a subtle move, but yet it is so deadly as well. And Nihal plays queen c1. Seems to be a very simple move, yet such a deadly move as well. Because now, king can't play h7. Because if he does that, then he have bishop d3, and there's a discovered attack on the queen. So he can't play that. And if he plays king g7 instead, it's still ugly because you have e into f6, then you have to capture the king into f6, and then you have queen into f6. This is also not looking good for black. This queen c1 move turned out to be such a strong move, and you could see that, you know, black must be regretting a lot playing his queen on c7, which at first glance actually be a very strong move. But you know, white has definitely taken advantage of that. So over here, black plays queen into e5, queen into h6 check. We have king g8, and now the next move by Nihal is, in my point of view, the strongest, the most brilliant move I have ever seen. So you can see that, you know, black is attacking the knight at the moment, and black seems to be in an okay position. So what can white do? Force black and gain some tempo. So Nihal plays f4. This is so absurd. I mean, at first glance, I mean, you know, black captures the knight with check. So now his king has to move over to h1. And, you know, black is also threatening to take the bishop as well. I mean, in all aspects, this seems to be like a no-brainer, right? I mean, black is getting so many pieces, but if black takes the bishop, then it's game over, because then you have rook f3, and this mate is unavoidable. I mean, there's literally nothing that you can do. That's what happens if you capture the bishop as well. But still, you could see that black is 2 pieces up, 6 points ahead in material. So instead he plays queen e4. So we have rook f3. So again, this is unavoidable. There's literally nothing can be done. So we have queen g6. So we have rook g3. Black has to capture it. And now we have h into g3. And even though you might be wondering, okay, the game must be over, but it is not, because you can see that even though white has his queen, you know, black has an extra rook, an extra bishop, and an extra knight. So clearly black is still in the game. But right now it's all about coordination and using his 3 extra pieces effectively on the board. But you can see that, you know, black's pieces are still not developed yet. His knight is there, his bishop is there. The rooks aren't connected as well. So that's what Nihal is aiming for. Nihal is trying to exploit that with his queen, which can be deadly in 1-2 moves as well. So we have rook e8 and we have queen to f6. Well, there's no point for black trying to save that pawn as well. So then we have bishop e7. So black at this point is just trying to get rid of the queen and keep his king safe at the moment, because white having the queen will definitely just go for the king, who's not looking great at the moment. So we have queen h6, we have bishop f8, again attacking the queen, we have bishop queen g5 check, and yeah, bishop g7. So at this point black is thinking, okay, I kept my king safe, my bishop is now over to the g7 square, and I'm out of trouble. But still, these three pieces are disconnected and they're not looking great, so it's due time for them to play some part in this game. So he plays rook d1, we have knight d7, so black is clearly trying to get his knight over there to f6, but then white doesn't allow it, so Nihal plays bishop b5. Now he's pinning the knight, so you can see that, you know, white is not giving black room to breathe at all. So now we have f6. Nihal plays queen g6, again attacking the rook. So rook has to come over to e7. So slowly white is just choking black and making him uncomfortable. So we have another brilliant move, and it is rook d6. Rook d6 is just denying black of any opportunity to gain tempo or to develop his piece. This move may seem to make no sense at all, but then this rook is pressurizing so many pieces at the same time, the pawn, this knight, so everything hangs on the balance right now, and you know, it doesn't look good for black. So he plays h6. So Nihal goes over to bishop d3, eyeing this, but it's not a checkmating threat, but it's still a bit dangerous. So we have b5, we have queen e4. So black played b5 obviously, because I mean, it's about time his bishop gains some breathing space, but obviously Nihal sees it and plays queen e4, and now his bishop still can't move at all, and in turn the queen is attacking the rook, as well as it's in a double attack on the pawn as well. So he has to play rook a7. Now he captures the pawn. Now rook. So now we have knight c5. So for this, white plays queen h7. King goes over to f8. And he plays rook c6, attacking this bishop. For that, you have rook c7. We have rook captures. And we have bishop f5. So we have bishop b7, finally the bishop is now in the game, and we have b4. Very strong move, because this knight doesn't have much squares to go. He can't go over here, can't go over here, and there's very little room for the black knight. So he goes over to d7, and we have bishop e6. Now the queen is threatening g8, and this is very deadly. So we have king e7. So white could capture the queen, so that king, but then the king would capture the bishop. So then Nihal captures the knight first, and then he captures the bishop. So king e8, and we have queen at f6, and you can see that, you know, white has three passed pawns, and these are all connected, and it doesn't look good for black. If we have rook f7, queen c3. Then we have like a couple of moves as well. So at this point, Francesco is trying his best, but Nihal doesn't even give him a single chance. So he's keeping his queen here so that the rook doesn't come over to d2 and attack the pawn. So, you know, Nihal is not giving him any chance whatsoever. We have rook e8. Now the king goes over to g1 just to keep it safe. And now g4, and we have rook e4, and Nihal just plays g5. There's no point capturing the pawn, because then we have queen d2, check as well as attacking the rook. So we have rook c4, we have queen at 7 check, and it was at this point that Francesco resigned the game because this game is basically over and there's really no point for Francesco to go further. So this game absolutely shows Nihal's brilliance at all levels, and I mean you saw like a couple of brilliant moves that were very hard to find, and I'm not surprised at all that this game actually won the award for the Brilliancy Prize. So I hope you all enjoyed. Please do like and subscribe to my channel, and also let me know in the comments if you want me to cover any other games as well as cover any opening traps as well. So stay tuned. Thank you.